Considering today's movie doesn't have a lot of production history or trivia to bounce itself off of, I figured this episode would be a good opportunity to show the inner workings of how Moonbeam Entertainment functioned as a studio. Even though Charles Band did create it, additional help was required.
First, you had Empire Pictures veteran Debbie Dion, who was a producer that oversaw production and development of Moonbeam's films. Then you had newly appointed creative executive Scott Fay, tasked with seeking out what scripts are good enough to put to film. On the sidelines, you had Michael Carducci doing script doctor work, and Madman's Matthew Weiner doing uncredited rewrites when needed.
And with their powers combined, they are able to create harmless family entertainment. Albeit movies like this. Beanstalk was one of Moonbeam's... Oh, wait, hold it, stop the clip montage. Can we play a little bit of the score for a moment? This sounds familiar. Yet to begin, and already this film is feasting on the table scraps of Hook.
In fact, that's kind of a major way of putting it. While Beanstalk does stand on its own, given some fairy tales and folklore are public domain, it's not too hard to see what this one was trying to clone. And granted, there's a lot of possibilities here, taking classic fantasy and giving it a modern spin.
Parts of it work, parts of it don't work. Let's examine this yarn to see exactly how much of it holds up.
The story focuses on a boy named Jack Taylor, played by J.D. Daniels. Much like his counterpart in the original story, he's got his head in the clouds by coming up with big ideas via Talkboy tape recorder.
Big idea number 1010, bath towel-sized moist towelettes. Big idea number 957, sugar-frosted veggies.
Big idea, volume 2. Plastic surgery for giants.
Note to myself, buy more cassette tapes.
Sadly, not all of them are big hits.
Your idea of putting in a drive-thru didn't help either.
Are you serious? I mean, it worked for fast food. It should work for your five and dime, right?
Oh, sure. You may laugh now. Wait until 2020 when those come in handy during the pandemic. At least it'll be more effective than curbside pickups. And if you recognize a little bit of J.D. Daniels' voice... Well, you'd be surprised because he actually did voice a Nickelodeon character, but only in the show's pilot. Can you guess which one?
Okay, I'm gonna shoot for the gap between second and third.
Just try not to get hit, okay?
Yeah, good strategy.
Hey! He was almost Arnold.
Unlike our last feature, there is a conflict established here. Parts of Jack's hometown, Rockville, is about to undergo foreclosure due to various late loan payments. Stupid, you say? Just go with it. Among the poverty is Jack's mother, Rebecca, played by Amy Stauch. And I have to admit, I like how this parent is a bit more down-to-earth and knows how to sacrifice the best she can for her son. It's kind of sweet in its own way.
Yes, you got me the ones with the high impact cushions. Yes, awesome.
Wait a minute, Ma. You can't afford these.
Oh, tips were good today.
Ma, but still.
No, Ma. No, we may be having our troubles, but I want you to have everything I can possibly give you.
The only thing that doesn't work is they try to shoehorn a love interest one of the shop owners, played by David Naughton. Maybe it's because they don't share too many scenes together, but I felt there was more chemistry between him and Jenny Agutter in American Werewolf in London than him and Missy from the Bill and Ted movies here.
Maybe I gotta put it another way. I like you a lot, Rebecca. But if you don't feel the same way, it's okay, because...
Good night, Perry.
Good night, and remember, there are no strings on me.
Right.
Bye, Rebecca.
Don't tell me. It's because I'm a werewolf, isn't it?
Speaking of well-known performers, we also get Margaret Kidder from the Superman franchise as a cryptozoologist professor named Kate Winston.
Hey! Hey, you child!
Just so you're aware, she did this role at least 2 years before her big mental health crisis. Just saying.
To describe her character, picture Doc Brown if he snorted Indiana Jones and Simon the Monster Hunter while sipping from the brain of John Lithgow's comedic acting, and this would be the result.
We're about to discover something that's never been seen before. Yeah. It's the find I've been waiting for all my life. It'll prove my theories are correct.
Oh. Her determination is to prove the Jack and the Beanstalk story is real after finding giant beans in the desert, along with this fossil.
Humongo sapiens.
Humongo sapiens by foot. Those are just the remains of the Castle Grayskull set from the live-action He-Man movie.
Unlike the story where Jack trades a cow for a sack of beans from a mysterious man, Jack nearly gets run over by Hyper's Hell Lois Lane, where the fossilized beans end up in Jack's possession.
They look like eggplants. Great. This is just what I need to pay off, Leech.
Okay, this might sound crazy, but what if they turn out to be tiny dinosaurs inside of those-
Don't even think about it, Jack. That's just too stupid.
And just like in the fairy tale, the beans grow overnight into a giant stalk that immediately turns Rockville into a major tourist attraction. Yeah, probably not as big of a commotion compared to when Jonah Nightingale was touring in town, but I guess it's worthy to drive hundreds of miles to see a giant miraculous beanstalk in someone's backyard. However, this does not please our villain, the banker Richard Leech.
Hello, Lurch.
The name's Leech.
As he plans to own the town for perhaps the most ridiculous scheme I have ever heard in any family movie I've seen. Take a listen.
When I own everything, I'm gonna flood this town with water from the dam. I'll create a lake and build the biggest vacation resort this side of Vegas on top of this...
Truly a plan that only Bull from Night Court could cook up.
Out with the old, in with the new. Get sick and die, we'll replace you too.
Also, I don't exactly see the probability of flooding a town just for a resort, but even that's impossible to pull off in real life. Even Lex Luthor's plan to make the Pacific Coast a floating island is more plausible compared to this.
I'll admit there were a few problems.
And yes, this is Richard Mole from Night Court, but some folks might recognize his voice from another familiar Saturday morning cartoon show.
It must be studied by our top scientists.
Mr. Leech, do you really believe there's a giant at the top of the beanstalk?
I haven't ruled out the possibility. That's one of the other reasons that I am cutting down this beanstalk today!
I couldn't let that wimp Dent destroy me. I had to teach the little man some respect. Everybody needs respect.
That's right. Two-Face is playing the bad guy in a Moonbeam Entertainment movie.
Two-Face used to be Harvey Dent, D.A. Then he had acid spilled on his face, and he underwent a certain transformation, wouldn't you?
Look, it was either that or bring up the fact that he played the evil ghost in Scary Movie 2, but I think I'll get more material out of him as Harvey Dent here.
Jack and his mother get evicted, so Banker Dent can stop them from profiteering off the beanstalk, The more I think about it, maybe it's because of this particular plotline alone as to why this movie was originally alluded to being titled Beanstalk, S-T-O-C-K, as opposed to what it was titled in the final cut, Beanstalk. But, oh well.
As Winston offers him a night in her magic school bus science van. For some weird reason, it leads to a comedic version of the Scar show-off scene from Jaws, which starts off cute enough.
Scuba diving in the Loch Ness. Guess who bit me?
It's absolutely nothing. Lucy freezed it to me with a blender and home mech class.
But then it takes a weird dark turn that certainly makes me question how this went under the MPAA radar.
Have you ever been conscious when the cold blade of a knife slowly severs through your seven layers of flesh and cuts you open like a watermelon, and then a slimy creature is licked from your insides?
It's all true.
Doctor had to give me a C-section when you were born.
What a performance! Very good!
Encore! Encore!
Yes,
what a performance!
Thanks. You know, before my husband died, I was trying to make it as an actress.
I got nothing. Except this clip I've been hanging on to for the past couple minutes.
It's your mom, dude.
Speaking of acting, let's talk about the performances so far. Given the overly cartoon nature, everyone does fine for the most part. Given the low budget nature, it's clear everyone is trying to have fun. There are times when the acting gets a bit too over the top, but it's mostly when Kidder and Maul are on screen, chewing up the scenery. Yet the biggest scene stealer is the bully Danny, played by Patrick Renna. And that's not just because it's ham from The Sandlot, it comes from the writing and the performance. Instead of making him a cliché tough guy or something of a meathead, they make Danny a smart bully, which actually provides comedic potential. Yeah, he does the usual mean tough guy tropes, but there's an added twist with him getting straight A's and really knowing his Shakespeare well.
To be or not to be? That's the question you should be asking yourself, you little freak! Conscience is but a word that cowards use. Devised at first to keep the strong in awe. Now cracks the noble heart. Good night, sweet prince. And the flights of angels sing thee to thy rest.
Wrong us. Shall we not revenge?
You can just tell Renna is having the time of his life soaking up every scene he's in. So after Doc provides proof of her theory, Jack believes history can repeat itself and plans to climb up the beanstalk with Bully in tow because, well, script said so. As they make their way to the giant's world where...
Let's take a small nostalgia break. Trust me, you're not ready for this.
Tough day, huh, kiddo?
We're doing fractions in math. And Gracie Gibson kissed me on the playground in front of everybody.
Doc, it sounds like you need a bedtime story.
Mom.
With car chases?
Cool.
When your day needs a little turnaround, Blockbuster has 9,000 ways to make it a Blockbuster night.
How about another story?
Yeah, I got one. With boys kissing girls.
A horrible nightmare!
Somebody call me?
We were all tiny and the cave kids were giants. They could make us move. And then a strange voice said...
No, every McDonald's $1.99 hamburger Happy Meal comes with one of six Dynamotion-powered dinosaur toys like Earl and everybody's favorite...
Let me guess!
Baby! One with each $1.99 McDonald's Happy Meal you buy your kids.
What you want is what you get.
Then I heard music.
At McDonald's today.
All right, son, point out the animal that did this to you.
The beast is back, now with 100 levels of pain. Donkey Kong, new for Game Boy.
So, if this movie is Full Moon's answer to Hook, then we can definitely say your determination for whether or not you're going to enjoy this movie or not clearly lies in the second half. In the case of Beanstalk, it's really more of a reinvention of the fairy tale as opposed to a retelling. So there's a lot of possibilities you can get out of it. And in regards to how to depict the world of the giants in this movie,
man, this place is fantastic.
Given the low budget standards of this flick, it's actually not half bad.
Instead, we get a world where everything is 30 years behind. So it's a land of giants living in a 1950s, 1960s style aesthetic.
What would you like, handsome?
Oh, just some muffins. Muffins.
Truly, they fit the visual description of a 1960s nuclear family. On top of that, it does feel like an opposite parallel to our own world, as the giants are distinctly hideous in look and treat common humans as aliens. Admittingly, it's an interesting concept, if it weren't for two things that bug me. In the giant world, humans are referred to as little people. The daughter of the family is played by Cindy Sorensen, who provided Pinhead's hands for Puppet Master 1 and 3. The idea to see a little person play a giant child is unique at first, but it gets somewhat bothersome when her father keeps referring to humans as little people.
Are little people real?
Well, some folks think they are. There's been a number of sightings of little people, but there's never been enough evidence to prove their existence. You see, little people, they don't really look like they're drawn in the storybooks. No, no, they actually have one eye. Little people! I am going to catch you, little people.
Don't you think you're too old to believe in little people?
I sit on it!
And even if this movie did come out in 1984, it's still a little awkward to hear, given how there is a little person among the cast. Talk about little people, big world. But even then, there's also this joke.
But the government, obviously covering up their existence. Darn that President Nixon! I wish we'd elected that Kennedy guy. He may not be as handsome as Nixon, but he's a whole lot smarter.
Good gravy, butine. First Prehysteria 3, and now this. I mean, granted, Oliver Stone did get into hot water with his JFK feature, but was this a thing back then? I mean, what's up with these awkward jokes? It's not as bad as what Prehysteria 3 did, but let me put it this way.
During the 1990s, there was a strange nostalgic fixation for the 1960s, much akin to how folks in the 1980s were nostalgic for the 1950s. You had some movies and TV shows that were definitely looking back upon what was big in the pop culture norm, but you had some other films and TV shows taking a really big stab at some of the social politics of that time period.
Why do you need college? Let's stick to our plan. After graduation, we load up my bus and travel the country, just following the music.
That's not a plan, that's a bad vacation.
Once in a while, you had some that did it rather cleverly.
Take this scum away.
I believe I'm supposed to be read my Miranda rights. Now,
And most of the time, you had some that were a little too on the nose.
The 60s are over and we lost, so just get with the program, all right?
In the case of Beanstalk, it feels a little more shoehorned in than actually making a statement or doing something with it. And don't be wrong, it's there, but it doesn't really seem to play around with it that much, outside of one or two tiny things.
Boy, it's a good thing I saved this spacesuit from when I stowed away in Apollo 11.
Apollo 11?
Really? I mean, Neil Armstrong didn't think much of my moon man theories, but oh boy, he sure was a party animal.
Oh sure, next thing you'll be telling me, this is the actual footage from the moon landing. Come to think of it, who wrote this? That name is mighty familiar. Let's see here. Oh, it's Michael Davis. Some of his credits include that Michael Davis.
The saving grace of these scenes is easily the giant, and it's not how he is written, it's really from the performance of Stuart Pankin. Most of the material he is given is not smart or funny, but I'm surprised Pankin really tries to make this material work. He basically has the essence of a father who acts like a big kid who believes tiny humans exist.
No matter what, I am not going to say little people. It just feels weird.
Anyway, the giant is obsessed to the point he practically tries to go the full 9 yards to prove their existence. And arguably this kind of character has been done before with another father character Stuart Pankin played prior to Beanstalk. As much as I don't want to compare apples to Laffy Taffy, I do feel that Dinosaurs showcase Pankin's range better as the writers gave him funny and interesting material to work from.
And I am the mighty Megalosaurus, the king of the dinosaurs. The Thunder Lizard!
The Tyrannosaurus Rex is king of the dinosaurs.
That's debatable.
No, it's not. I dated one in high school.
Here, it feels more of a clone of that, but it's not as sharp. Take this scene, for example, when he plays with his daughter's toys.
Well, look at here! A gold coin for G.I. Jim! Well, I'm gonna have to steal that because I am so greedy!
You got crazy!
Oh, look, money! I have to have it! Oh, help me! Help me! Oh, I'm trapped and I can't get up! Oh, help! Help!
Oh, no!
No, Mr. Tarantula! Don't eat me! Don't eat me!
Okay. Clearly, this is more from Pankin's performance than how the scene is written. It's clear that he's trying to really work with this stuff, and you can tell he's having a blast with it. Perhaps too much, though. He seems to be overselling it so much, and it's a shame because there could have been some really sharp writing here, but just to see him take it and just really fly with it is both hilarious and kind of fascinating. Clearly, he is the saving grace of this movie.
What kind of a stupid idiot believes in little people?
Oh, Mom!
But when there's a funny line or two, at least it's in little tiny eye drops. Give or take.
Perhaps the most disgusting and surprisingly gory scene is when Jack and Danny have to hide inside of all the places they have to go.
You can check in. But you can't check out.
I mean, wow. Can you think of the last movie you saw where a kid gets doused in bug guts and then accidentally punches his hand into one? It's the only movie I can think of where something like that happens. Ugh.
Everything around here is giant. And giants mean business.
It's probably best that I bring up here that Alchemy FX did a lot of the visual and makeup effects. Not only just for this movie, but for a lot of Full Moon production movies, too. I mentioned them a little bit in my review of Remote, but here's a better breakdown. It was a special effects facility Charles Band established exclusively for his films. Granted, other effects studios like K&B would join in when needed. It was headed by Michael Deak, who worked prior on a variety of titles from Empire Pictures up until the falling out with Paramount in late 1994. From what I can understand, based on the research I could gather at this time, the warehouse that facilitated Alchemy FX shut down, and instead was merged over into another one called Optic Nerve that was shepherded by Glenn Hetrick. I know I'm getting a little off track here, but this is something I wanted to expand upon that was briefly mentioned in a couple of past videos. That, and given the website gives some fair hints that this was a studio that did some previous work with Full Moon, I didn't want to come off as giving any incorrect information. I'm a bit of a stickler for things like that.
The special effects work here is impressive at best for a low-budget feature. The forced perspective and composite shots still look good. Compared to Dollman's effects, which suffer from poor planning, you can tell they pulled out the stops here with a variety of large-scale sets. Even if it's minimal, there are some shots that still make me wonder how they did this. Originally, Full Moon would attach a bonus video segment at the end of each tape, dubbed Video Zone. It was a look behind the scenes, and it was a rather cool way to see how all that work was done right after the movie. They accompanied it not only with Full Moon films, but even with some of the Moonbeam movies, too. It really showed the effort, even if the movie at times was lackluster.
Alas, when Beanstalk was released to home video, there was no Video Zone segment attached to it. The closest we got was a Margaret Kidder interview that was placed in the one for Prehysteria 2. I'd be curious to know if one was filmed and possibly got lost during the split between Paramount Pictures and Full Moon. However, some evidence I was able to gather online probably suggests that one never materialized.
Anyway, back to the film. Once Jack and Danny find a change of clothes, they try to find any sign of riches to bring back, but they find not much is valuable.
Ah, foolery, sir. Just walk about the orb like the sun. There's no gold here, not even a penny. And the stupid $5 bill is worthless. You're killing me, Smalls!
So Danny decides to sell Jack to the giant, and I kinda like how the green megalosaurus here proves that he's not that dumb.
No deals, Kent. I need one of you for questioning, and the other perhaps for dissection?
No!
Hand, idiot!
The rest of the climax is cartoony as it gets. Leech plans to detonate the beanstalk with explosives while Doc and Rebecca try to infiltrate the place with sleeping gas. Meanwhile, the giant chases after Jack and reformed Danny, leading to a series of slapstick pain, including a special Hawaiian nutshot.
Ideally, you want something that doesn't hurt but looks really bad. This is a whole other story. The opposite.
Comedy aside, this is too complex. It's bad enough we have the giant, but Leech's determination to destroy the beanstalk just feels unnecessary to me. It only serves as a ticking clock, as we the audience know it won't go off until the very end. However, we do get to see the giant come down and rampage about the town. Even if this takes place in the last 6 minutes of the movie, I will admit, there are some solid jokes here, even if the moment is brief.
They've captured some of my people and imprisoned them in stone! The fiends!
God. I admit, when I was rewatching this movie with a friend of mine, this got the biggest laugh from both of us. 70 minutes into the movie, and a solid, funny, memorable joke. Only about 70 minutes into the movie. Oh, and also there's this gag, too.
Mets lose to Giants. All right!
Why couldn't this be the movie? Forget the evil banker's stupid plan to flood the hometown. Why couldn't midway through the film they just have the giant come down, look around our modern world, riff upon it, and just sort of observe and examine? It would make for a much more interesting movie than what we already got. This alone should have been the major conflict. Giant comes down, messes with the town, maybe explore about, and either have a change of heart or try to bring stuff back to his home. It certainly sounds more imaginative, and truly provides what waste potential there was in hindsight.
There!
Look! Where are you?
Where?
Well, there's something you don't see every day. What have you got left?
Sorry, Beckman. I'm terrified beyond the capacity for rational thought.
Oh, wanna guess how the giant is defeated?
Don't hurt me. Don't hurt me again. Don't hurt me anymore.
Funny, isn't it? The human was impervious to our most powerful magnetic fields. Yet in the end, he succumbed to a harmless sharpened stick.
Really? This is what causes him to flee up the beanstalk? If a splinter to his hand didn't stop him, then why should he make such a big deal about this one? Thus, Leech is arrested thanks to a loophole.
He was gonna blow up you and the Beanstalk. We're arresting Mr. Leech for attempted murder.
No one's gonna stop me from blowing up that Beanstalk!
Stop!
Poor Harvey. So filled with anger. Do you think there's any hope?
Where there's love, there's hope, Commissioner.
Doc plans to find Chewbacca's family, Missy decides to get together with the Wolfman, and as for the Beanstalk...
Okay. We all know that had to happen at some point. Especially given how there's no Beanstalk 2. But my mind is more on the fact on how that giant celery stalk is going to come crashing all the way down from the sky. Really think about it. A lot of houses are going to get crushed that way. I know it's predictable, but I will give them the absolute gall for going with quite the openly bleak ending. But that's okay, because the giant got his proof that small humans exist! Oh, just give it a few years. He'll end up starring in a direct-to-video sequel, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, either way.
So, Beanstalk is not good, but I can say it's not that bad compared to the previous entries we looked at. It's watchable in its own guilty pleasure way, but it still won't be everyone's cup of tea. Still, I can tell everyone here is aiming for a tone that fits the cartoon nature of the movie. It's clear they don't want this to be taken seriously, yet it's kind of hard to turn your brain off when most of the ridiculous plot elements come from the Leech character and some over-the-top performances. At the same time, it does feel like there is wasted potential despite some impressive yet dated effects and a good majority of funny moments, mostly from the Giant and the Danny character. Still, when you think of the premise and all that could have been, it does leave one feeling for something bigger than this.
Given how harmless this movie is, younger audiences will be okay with it. But in regards to older viewers, you know what? I weirdly recommend it. Yeah, it's not a masterpiece, and you might not get much out of it, but it's so fascinating to see how many of these character actors are so committed to really selling the believability on this that it also goes into a territory of so bad it's good, or a form of accidental comedy that makes it mesmerizing. And given what we had to deal with prior, yeah, I'd say this one so far is the best, or at least the second best. But if you're looking for something a bit more serious...
What if the fairy tale...
The beans.
The movement.
...were true?
Five. Ready or not, it's gonna come.
Jack and the Beanstalk, the real story.
You know, despite the 3-hour length, yeah, might as well. I mean, if you really want something more serious and deep. But hey, with Jim Henson's name attached to it, you can't go wrong. Well, so far, this hasn't been too bad. I mean, granted there were some bumps on the road with Prehistoria 2 and 3, but given the nature and progression of these Moonbeam Entertainment films, they're kind of getting better. I mean, who knows? Maybe it'll be smooth sailing from here on out.
Pet Shop. Sometimes you can find a little miracle where you least expect it.
Is he too cute or what?
On second thought, I think I'll take a Patreon request next. Because, boy, am I gonna need something to nullify my senses before I take on that disaster.
Killer of giants threatens us all. Mountains of madness standing so tall.
on June 27th. There's only one name you need to remember. Hercules.
What you folks need is a hero.
Hercules!
Hercules.
Hercules.
From the creators of Aladdin and the Little Mermaid.
The hero is only as good as his weapon.
Get it!
Comes Disney's mightiest comedy of all.
I've got 24 hours to get rid of this bruiser. And you are wearing his merchandise!
Hercules. Rated G.
Whoa, is my hair out?
Striking theaters June 27th.
Cut.
Oh boy, I had one of these when I was a kid. Sorry about that.